A little while ago, we did a series on entity framework. And one of the aspects of that I showed you was the idea of code first from DB, where we take an existing database and get the tool to generate some C# code to have classes that represent the tables in the database. And if we take a quick look at that, what we had was this. So we had our tables, like an author table and a books table with various columns, and then the corresponding classes. There we'd got our authors class, there we'd got our books class. And there's nothing particularly fancy about them, but the point is I did not write those for myself. Those were classes that were generated based on the data in the database by some tool. And clearly that's a general sort of problem that you'll want to solve in all sorts of different situations where you need to generate C# code based on some other data. And that's something that is supported within Visual Studio, within C#, and it's generally put under the heading of code analysis. Now, something to watch out for, this has changed completely between .NET Framework and .NET Core. What I'm doing is .NET Core, .NET 5 actually, but it is still possible in .NET Framework, but it works in a rather different way. So let's see what we've got here. And what I want to do here is put together basically the most simple program you'll ever write, a hello world. So if I were writing this directly as C#, it would look like this. We've got a comment just to point out it's generated code and therefore it may be regenerated, so we shouldn't edit it directly. We've got a using system, we've got a namespace, we've got a program, we've got a main, and then we've got our console write line hello world. So obviously trivial to write for yourself, but we're going to see how we can do this using this code analysis library. So I've added the NuGet package for that. So we've got the general code analysis and then specifically the C# code analysis that I'm going to use. And then in our program, I have simply for now put in this create tree, which is going to create a syntax tree that contains that program structure. Now, a few videos back, we looked at a design pattern called the composite pattern, which was there for putting together tree structures. And that's exactly the pattern that's used here in this syntax tree. So what we'll see if we look again at the structure, the tree structure is at the root of it, we've got the compilation unit itself. Then inside there, we've got elements for the comment, for the using system, and for the namespace. Then inside the namespace, we've got the program. Inside the program, we've got the main. Inside the main, we've just got the one statement, but obviously we could have more. And it's exactly what you'll see as a composite pattern. And in fact, the gang of four have defined a separate pattern known as interpreter, which really is this sort of thing. It's the composite pattern applied to language structures. Now, I'm not sure whether it really needs to be a separate pattern in its own right or whether it's just a specific example, but it's certainly a well-established way of doing these things. So that's what we need to do. We need to create the syntax tree representing that code. And the way that we tend to do this is actually, certainly it's easy to think about it if you build it from the bottom up. So if we start at the middle and work out rather than on the outside and work in. And so the very first thing we want to have is going to be that console write line statement. And so let's do that. So what we'll do in here is we will say var console write line. So that's just a variable to represent the statement I'm going to create. And then we say equals, and then we've got syntax factory, which is a factory to create all the complex elements that we've got in here. And this is going to be of type member access expression. So we're calling a member on an object, we're calling write line on console. And into there, we're going to put, first thing is going to be this thing called a syntax kind. And we're saying what kind of expression it's going to be. And this is going to be a simple member access expression. And then we've got to specify what it is. So we're going to then put in the components of it. We're going to put the thing that we're calling it on, the left-hand side, and that's going to be syntax factory dot identifier name, and then that's going to be console. And then we're also going to have syntax factory dot identifier name, and then write line. And so that's set up the basic expression. We still need to put in the parameter of hello world in there, and we do that by combining them into a statement. So we'll call this statement, and then that equals syntax factory dot expression statement, and in there we're going to combine the two. So we have to have, as the first parameter, we've got another one of these things from the syntax factory dot invocation expression. That's going to take our console write line that we've just put together, and then pop on the end of that the arguments. So we say dot with argument list, and then actually things get quite complicated there. So I've already written in advance this helper function create single argument, and you can see there's just a whole load more depth to this. But ultimately, we pass in the value, and that down the bottom there gets passed in as this literal value. So save typing all of that out. We're just going to say on this with argument list, create single argument, and that is where we're going to put in hello world. So that's what we actually want our program to do right at the heart of it. But then we've got to wrap that all up in the other bits and pieces that we need. So we know, again, let's just check back to the code, that that statement has to go inside a main. So now we're going to have var main equals, and then once again, syntax factory. We're going to have this time a method declaration, because main is a method. And then the first thing we have to declare on our method declaration is the return type. Got to be a bit careful here because the return type is void, and void is a special case. It's a keyword in C#. So we have to do this in a slightly odd way. We say syntax factory dot predefined type, and then we put that all together by saying syntax factory dot token, and then syntax kind dot void keyword. So that's how we get the keyword void in there. And then we can simply specify main. Don't have to do anything too fancy about that, because although it's got to be called main, it's not actually a reserved word in the language. And then on to the end of main, we need to add some modifiers, because we know we need it to be static. That's how main works. And again, we can see that if we just check back on the code we're trying to reproduce. So what we then do on here is we do a dot add modifiers. And again, this is going to be another one of these syntax factory token. And in this case, it's going to be a token of the static keyword. So we just put in here syntax kind dot static keyword. So that's going to add the static on the end of that. And so you can see it's quite complicated in terms of the bits and pieces to put together. We've got this factory to help us. We've got syntax kinds to help us with predefined concepts in the language. So that's declared our main, but we've still got to put our statement inside main. So we do that with a dot add body statements. And then we can see that will actually take an array of them. So if you had multiple statements, it'd be reasonably straightforward. But we've just got the one that we can put into there. So that should have set up our main. Main, though, exists in a class called program. So that's the next thing we're going to do. We're going to say var program equals, and then syntax factory. This one is a class declaration. So that's what we'll have in there. And the class is going to be called program. And then the class is going to have members. So we just say add members. And again, it's an array, but we've only got one of them because this is a simple example. So there we've got main. So we've now, working back down, we've got the program. The program contains main, and the main contains our console write line. Nearly there now. What we then have to do is put all of this inside a namespace, because again, we can see we've got this namespace codingtutorials.demo. So I'm going to say var root namespace equals syntax factory dot namespace declaration. And then into there, we put syntax factory dot identifier name. And then the name of our namespace, which was going to be coding tutorials.demo. And then we want to populate that namespace with our program. And so we say root namespace equals, and then thing to watch out for here, when we do something like add, it actually returns a new object with the elements added into it. So we've got to say root namespace equals root namespace dot add and then program. So now we're almost there. If we just again take a look at our code that we're trying to recreate, still a couple of things missing. The really important one is we've got to have that using directive, because I didn't say system.console.writeline in the body of it. So we've got to have the using directive. So what we need to then do is we say var using directive equals syntax factory dot using directive. So there's a lot of these things, but most of them are quite sensibly named. And then in that one, we're going to do a syntax factory dot parse name. And then that's just going to be system. We're also going to have that comment. So let's put that in there as well. So let's have var comment equals syntax factory dot comment. And then thing you ought to remember, even though obviously we're declaring a comment, we still include the double slash for the comment. And then here we're just going to put generated code, do not edit. And then finally, we're going to put that all together. We're going to say var unit equals syntax factory dot compilation unit. And then we can chain all these together. So we're going to say dot add usings, and then we can put in our using directive. We're going to say dot add members, and in there we're just going to put in our root namespace. And then lastly, the third top level thing, we're going to add our comment, and that's done with the strange thing with leading trivia. So trivia is just a general description of things like comments. And then with leading just means put it at the beginning. And so that's put together our compilation unit, which is a in code hierarchical representation of what I'd already written there. Then all we've got to do is from that get this syntax tree. So we simply say return unit.syntaxTree. And then that just gives us back the whole tree that we want there. Well, now we've got our tree, what can we do with it? Well, we could actually build that, so we could compile it down to intermediate language, put it into an assembly, and indeed that is what we're ultimately going to do, but we're going to leave that to the next video because that's the next step on. What we're going to do here is simply demonstrate what we've done there by generating C# source code from that structure. And that's exactly what we saw in the example with the code first from DB. So what I'll do, I will get hold of my syntax tree. So we'll just say syntax tree tree equals, and then call the method we've just written there. And then if I here just do a console write line, I can say tree dot get root, and then just to full string. And that will parse that entire hierarchy and generate the source code. And if I run that up, you'll see it's worked, but it does have this slight problem that it has just splodged everything onto a single line, which isn't readable or any help at all, really. So the one other trick we've got to do here is on that get root, we can then say dot, and various ways we could format it, but the easiest one is just this normalize white space, and that will basically take the structure and put in indentation and just the normal way that these things should be displayed. So now when we do that, we can see that we're getting exactly what we had in the original code. So that's how we can generate that. And as I say, we might want to go on to compile that, but we might simply want to put that into another project as one of the listed files in solution, which is exactly what was happening when we had the code generation for the code first from DB. So you can see it's quite a complicated thing to do. There's a lot of detail in there, and you would probably be wanting to write some software to automate that, which I'll be putting together in a later video. But for now, we can see the features are there. It's perfectly possible to write C# code that generates this syntax tree, which can be then used to generate more C# code. So I hope you enjoyed that. I hope you found it useful. If you did, do click the like button, do subscribe, and next time come along and see how we can actually compile that down to intermediate language.